For years, we were graced by Rachel Maddow's insane conspiracy peddling about Russiagate that turned out to be false. First, it was the Mueller report, and Rachel Maddow was nearly brought to tears. Though she denies crying, it really does look like she's choking up when it turns out this whole Russiagate spy thriller narrative was nothing but, well, fake news. And then the Inspector General's report came out, the Horowitz report came out, showing that the Steele dossier was largely complete BS, and once again, Rachel Maddow was left with egg on her face. It would seem that finally, MSNBC and many cronies in the mainstream leftist establishment are facing a reckoning. It's not just the right now that's calling out Rachel Maddow, but more people on the left are being critical of MSNBC and the insane narratives they peddle to try and prop up establishment crony candidates. Now, I'll tell you this, man. For the past several years, Trump has ragged on the media for being fake news, and many of these progressives were more than happy to stand side by side with Rachel Maddow and other CNN-type media personalities and DNC cronies to claim, oh, Trump is attacking the free press. Until primary season started, and they started to reap the benefits of a corrupt crony media. Well, now we're seeing stories like this, Rachel Maddow's reckoning, and boy, it's just too good. Because, you know, people have called me essentially a media critic as they try to figure out exactly what I am. Why is Tim so critical of the left and the Democrats? Well, it's because their allies in media have been propping up their insane BS forever. And you know what? I really wish the Bernie supporters and the Yang supporters and the Young Turks supporters were more on board with this from the get-go, because now they are the one being hurt by it. So thank you now for calling it out. So here's what I say to the Trump supporters, man. You know, it might be frustrating to finally see the Young Turks come out and say, hey, the media's lying about us, but now's not the time for gloating. Now's the time to shake their hand and say, welcome to the fight. This is what the media does. The media lies. And I don't mean literally every journalist. I mean the establishment corporate press is going to do whatever they can to protect their profit margin, even if it means propping up insane, psychotic BS like Rachel Maddow. But don't take it from me. Take it from Mr. Glenn Greenwald, one of the fiercest critics of Rachel Maddow. You know, I've never been a big fan of Glenn Greenwald. I'm not saying I don't like the guy. I'm critical of him in a lot of ways, but I gotta love the fact that him and many others like Michael Tracy and Aaron Matei have been progressives calling out the insane anti-Trump Russiagate conspiracy nonsense. Thank you for being there, and I mean that sincerely. Glenn tweeted this: there's no getting around the fact, no matter how much one wants to, that Rachel Maddow's performance on Russiagate was one of the most paranoid, unhinged, and fact-free debacles of sustained media propaganda, fear-mongering, conspiracy-mongering, and deceit in many years. Woo-hoo! Spicy, Mr. Greenwald. Yikes, that was harsh. It almost reminds me of when Tulsi Gabbard called Hillary Clinton the personification of rot. But anyway, let's actually start the story, and I'll show you this from the National Review, Rachel Maddow's Reckoning, highlighting the Washington Post's criticism of Rachel Maddow. I kid you not, I was shocked to see this. Of all outlets, the Washington Post has a 6-part series on the media's failure pertaining to the Steele dossier. And boy, do I feel good. I feel vindicated. I know the Trump supporters do, but hey, come on, progressives, get on board with this. The media ship is going down in flames, and it's about time someone called them out. Let's get started with this story from the National Review. Before we do, head over to timcast.com/donate if you'd like to support my work. There's a PayPal option, a crypto option, a physical address, but of course, the best thing you can do is share this video, and I'll tell you why. This video is not just for those who like the president or those who necessarily just hate the president. I'm going to show you Andrew Yang, Bernie Sanders, Cenk Uygur of the Young Turks. I'm going to show you how the media targets them as well. And we need to be calling out this system of corrupt fake news. Now I get it, man. You know, Trump comes out and says the fake news lies, and there are a lot of people like, you know, progressives at the Young Turks who absolutely want to jump on that anti-Trump train. But I'll tell you this, man, you got to give Trump this one because he's right. I know, Trump's not the most honest guy in the world, or maybe he is, depending on which outlet you read. But the point is, the media does lie. Look, you know, the way I've explained it, I don't care if you're a fan of Bernie, I don't care if you're a fan of Yang, I don't care if you're a fan of the Young Turks, but if the media comes out and lies about them, I will be the first in line to defend them, because I cannot stand for a world in which politics is determined by the uber wealthy dumping money into advertisements, going on TV and peddling this insane trash. Okay, but let's read otherwise. But anyway, the point is, I want to show you now how the progressives are getting on board with this. And thank you. thank you for finally pointing this out, because to me it was shocking. You know, 7-8 years ago during Occupy Wall Street, everybody knew the media was corrupt for some reason. The anger towards Trump was so thick and palpable that people on the left were willing to entertain the possibility the media was telling the truth? Okay, again, not all in the media. There are good news outlets. You're obviously watching me. You think I do a good job, and I'm a part of the media too. But for this one, we're going to be calling out MSNBC and Rachel Maddow. The National Review reports, you may recall that back in March 2017, MSNBC host Rachel Maddow shocked the world by declaring, "We've got Trump's tax returns." Then she later clarified she had obtained Donald Trump's 1040 form from 2005. Those who tuned into her program that evening had to watch a meandering 19-minute soliloquy and a commercial break before Maddow showed anything from the tax return, which wasn't much. Her guest, David K. Johnson, speculated that Trump may have also leaked photos of Melania. Okay. That night was a massive letdown for those who believed Maddow's initial announcement, but it previewed what we could expect from Maddow for the next 3 years. As the Washington Post's Eric Wemple lays out in exhaustive detail, in a review of Maddow's reporting and discussion of the Steele dossier, his assessment is scathing. He said, when small bits of news arose in favor of the dossier, let me stop real quick. For those that aren't familiar, the Steele dossier is the infamous document full of internet rumor that was published by BuzzFeed, and it was pretty much the basis for the Russiagate investigation. We now know that it is mostly bunk. I believe it's almost entirely bunk, but there's a lot of people who argue about it, but the fact remains, the Steele dossier is trash, internet rumor nonsense, and it was used to accuse Trump and some of his staff of being like Russian agents, and some of these claims are so insane and ridiculous, I can't even say them. Golden showers, women of the night in hotels in Russia, yeah, it was nuts. So now that you know what it is, let's read. When small bits of news arose in favor of the dossier, the franchise MSNBC host pumped air into them. At least some of her many fans surely came away from her broadcast thinking the dossier was a serious piece of investigative research, not the flim-flam quick-twitch game of telephone outlined in the Horowitz report. She seemed to be rooting for the document. And when large bits of news arose against the dossier, Maddow found other topics more compelling. She was there for the bunkings, absent for the debunkings, a pattern of misleading and dishonest asymmetry. Bravo, good sir, at the Washington Post. I was actually shocked to see that of all the outlets, the Washington Post actually ran a 6-part series condemning the media over their failures. And I'm actually very, very optimistic today. I'm optimistic for two reasons. To see the Washington Post actually come out, and for all their faults, and they've got them, to criticize the media, thank you, okay? There's still a lot of problems in media. There's still a lot of dishonesty. But I'm glad to see that Rachel Maddow is getting comeuppance from the Washington Post of all places. The National Review continues. Justice Department Inspector General Michael Horowitz issued his report earlier this month and concluded, much of the material in the Steele election reports, including allegations about Donald Trump and members of the Trump campaign relied upon in the Carter Page FISA applications, could not be corroborated. That certain allegations were inaccurate or inconsistent with information gathered by the Crossfire Hurricane team, and that the limited information that was corroborated related to time, location, and title information, much of which was publicly available. The night Horowitz released his report, Maddow ignored that and emphasized other conclusions. The Inspector General debunks that there was any anti-Trump political bias motivating these decisions. They debunked the idea that Christopher Steele dossier of opposition research against Trump was the basis for opening the FBI's Russia investigation. Wemple writes, asked to comment on how she approached the dossier, Maddow declined to provide an on-the-record response. Like other primetime cable news hosts who receive much more criticism, Maddow shows up every weeknight and tells a devoted audience, quote, the world is as you want it to be. Trump is the worst. He's committed many terrible crimes. A reckoning is coming. We will be vindicated. Her audience is not interested in hearing the host or guests declare. While we are vehemently opposed to Trump, but there is no evidence he's being blackmailed or controlled by the Russian government. Her program includes bits of news and other substances that appear to be like news, but are not. Fervent speculation, conjecture, assumption, theories. If it is too harsh to call it fake news, then it is news with artificial flavors and sweeteners designed to make it more exciting and appealing than it really is. Did you know that Rachel Maddow accused a cable TV network called One America News, of being Russian propaganda and was sued. And I guess she won on the basis that what she says is not reality. I'm not exaggerating. Take a look at these stories. This one from the AP, September 10th. One America News sues Rachel Maddow for $10 million. A conservative television network sued Rachel Maddow for more than $10 million on Monday for calling it paid Russian propaganda. One American News filed the federal defamation suit in San Diego. They say the lawsuit contends that Maddow's comments on her July 22nd show, MSNBC show, were retaliation after OAN President Charles Herring accused cable television giant Comcast of censorship. The suit contends that Comcast refused to carry the channel because it counters the liberal politics of Comcast's own news channel, MSNBC. A week after Herring sent an email to a Comcast executive, Maddow opened her MSNBC show by referring to a report in the Daily Beast that said an OAN employee also worked for Sputnik News, which is linked to the Russian government. In this case, the most obsequiously pro-Trump right-wing news outlet in America really literally is paid Russian propaganda, Rachel Maddow said. Well, you know, that's a pretty definitive statement to go on your show and defame a news outlet like that. I'm not saying you gotta be a fan of Trump or OAN, but at least be honest about it. They are not paid propaganda. They are just Trump supporters. Rachel Maddow, Russian propaganda, just opinions. Defamation suit fails. Why, yes, on October 22nd, Rachel Maddow said what she's claiming isn't supposed to be taken as news or fact. It's just supposed to be her thoughts and opinions on the matter. And I think it's, to an extent, fair. The problem is when Rachel Maddow pretends that it's the news. As the National Review shows, it's news-like. Fake news may be too harsh, but it's artificial flavors and sweeteners. So there has been, for a long time, a reckoning coming. But perhaps one of the most glorious would be, in my opinion, the fact that Jacobin Magazine, a socialist website, is, well, they're actively critical of Rachel Maddow, and I'm glad they are. They're also praising Crystal Ball of The Hill, and I'm also glad they are as well. Let me read some of this for you, because here's where I want to go with this. Rachel Maddow certainly is getting defended from establishment media. Look at this article from Columbia Journalism Review. They say this, MSNBC public editor, what if Rachel Maddow is right? Oh, please, just stop. She's not right. She's ridiculous, crony establishment nonsense, and even the progressive left and the socialists are not happy with her. You know why? We see the game being played with the media, how they're with, let me show you something. First of all, Cenk Uygur slams unconscionable New York Times report suggesting he defended David Duke, calling it a lie. Now, this isn't MSNBC, but we can see how the progressive left is being ripped apart by the media now that they're actually trying to play the game of politics. Check out this best of post from Reddit. They say this user posts an image gallery showing how the Bernie blackout or Bernie blindness is very real. Why, that's right. Numerous outlets, left to right, top down, whatever, omit Bernie Sanders from the press. They're now starting to call out CNN and MSNBC, CBS, even Fox, the LA Times, New York Times, etc. The media is biased. They don't want the progressive left to win. They don't want Trump to win. They want the crony establishment to win. And the worst of which, the visual history of the Yang media blackout. Now, this is MSNBC, and they're one of the worst culprits. Rachel Maddow exists to spin ridiculous stories about Russia trying to shut off the electricity in winter so that people freeze to death in Fargo. I'm not making that up. She literally did that. It's crazy. It's seriously crazy. And then MSNBC goes out of their way to make sure that even when they list the number 10 candidates, there's a blank spot for no Andrew Yang. Now look, I'm a fan of Tulsi Gabbard. She's my preferred choice. My second choice is Andrew Yang. And so of course I'm mad at the press, and of course I've been one of the first in line because they get smeared relentlessly. I'm glad to see Bernie Sanders supporters, Yang supporters, and even the Socialist magazine calling out the absurdity. So here's where I'm getting optimistic. First, we have a series, check this out, the story that stands. McClatchy won't back off its Michael Cohen Prague reporting. The Washington Post, first in a series of how the media handled the Steele dossier. Six different stories. Horowitz report confirms John Solomon's scoop on FBI spreadsheet regarding Steele dossier. Disinformation claim galls dossier author Christopher Steele. Here's another one. CNN lands an interview with its own contributor. Washington Post actually taking the other media outlets to task? A much cited defense of the Steele dossier has a problem. Bravo, good sir, Eric Wemple, for being one of the few people in media to call out the fake news that was propagated, because it was a no-holds-barred, by any means necessary, attempt to get rid of Donald Trump. That's not how you win. It didn't work. Impeachment didn't work. It has only made Trump stronger. It has only caused a further collapse in trust in media. And now, thankfully, I am very, very optimistic to see the populist left and right, whether or not they actually want to stand side by side and recognize this, they are now becoming more unified in their message that the media is trash. This story from Jacobin warms my heart. Of all of the political magazines or outlets to actually write something, you'd think I would not be a big fan of the socialists, but they're spot on 100% because my principles are as such. You can disagree with the socialists, but if we're being honest with each other, we might actually find a solution to our problems. I think the fact remains there are a lot of socialists who have some good ideas that might make our country better. I tend to disagree with most of their ideas, but I'm not so stupid to think I'm smarter than everybody. No, I think they probably see things I don't. I tend to lean more towards a mixed economy, slightly center-left, but still capitalistic system. But I think if we're being honest and acting in good faith, we're going to move forward very well. So when they say this, crystal ball is the anti-Rachel Maddow Bernie fans have been waiting for, I saw this story and I laughed. I love it. Crystal Ball is amazing. She's a fantastic host, and she's very much a more populist left figure. But she's also co-hosting a show with Sagar and Jetty, a conservative. And this is where my heart is truly warmed. Let me read you this passage. They say this. On Rising with Crystal and Sagar, Ball's political talk show at thehill.com, it is always a good morning. And Ball and her conservative co-host, Sagar and Jetty, are always happy to bring us an amazing show. Wow. Socialists praising a centrist outlet's show with a progressive and a conservative? That's awesome. That really is great. I think, you know, when you watch The Hill's Rising with Cigar and Crystal, they're honest. They have different political views. They're completely honest. That's one of the reasons why I really do like both of them as hosts, because I don't completely agree with either. But they approach issues like sane, rational, and real people, and even progressives and populists are recognizing they're doing a good job. But you know who absolutely hates The Rising show? You should really check these guys out. I shouldn't say these guys, okay, Crystal and Cigar on The Hill's Rising. It's the establishment press that loves Elizabeth Warren, that loves Joe Biden, okay? Whatever, man. If you like them, fine. But the point is, they get accused of being like Russian propaganda. You can tell what's really happening here. The old crony establishment, and look, I've got my qualms with the, you know, intersectional weirdo, you know, kind of like religious types. But if you're going to talk about the actual politics of the populist left and right, you know, American workers and things like that, I think there's a conversation to be had. And if we're at least being honest, we can move forward. But there's a guy named, I'm not going to name him because I don't think he deserves it, but he accused Trump sort of, you know, he said maybe Trump has been a Russian, you know, asset since the 1980s. And Rachel Maddow actually has this guy on the TV. Nobody wants to hear what these people have to say. Rachel, whatever these weird people who live in Trump delusion world, you know, look, you don't got to like the president, like I've said a million times, but come on, man, that's a step too far. But this guy also writes an article accusing Crystal and Cigar of being like, you know, Russian assets or something like that. That's how desperate the machine has become. I absolutely look forward to legitimate conversations between people who disagree with each other without the insane lies. And I'm not saying the right and the left are perfect, not even the populist right and left, but this absolutely is a light at the end of the tunnel. You know, they're essentially saying, like, they rag on Rachel Maddow, and I don't need to read through the whole article because you get the point, but they basically say that Rachel Maddow exists to serve, you know, the Democratic establishment candidates. You've got Joe Biden, you've got Pete Buttigieg, you've got Elizabeth Warren. Now, Buttigieg isn't, like, the biggest, but what I think we see with, you know, the candidates they prop up, it's that, well, Joe Biden's clearly establishment, he's the VP, then you clearly have Elizabeth Warren, who, in my opinion, is Hillary Clinton wearing a Bernie Sanders mask, pretending to be this populist leader to try and attract those voters away, and then Pete Buttigieg, who is literally just a reincarnation of your establishment Democrat character. That's what MSNBC is all about. And you end up with this, like, Andrew Yang actually boycotted MSNBC because they completely omit him. It's funny, isn't it? It's funny how for the longest time, Donald Trump said the fake news, the fake news, the fake news. And so many of these progressives were willing to say, oh, how dare Trump attack the press? But now that it's really reached them, they're starting to say, okay, you know, maybe this is a real problem. And my response to them is, hey man, welcome to the fight. If the New York Times wants to smear, you know, Cenk Uygur of the Young Turks, I absolutely made a video about it. So people wonder why it is that my videos tend to flow in a certain direction. It's because what the media is propping up. These deception, like, look, man, Fox News is one channel, okay? But I'll tell you this, shameless promotion. Follow me on Instagram, at TimCast. I showed a video where Fox News is covering protests, the weather over the holidays, Iran, you know, Mexico, Hong Kong, etc. And CNN is just doing Orange Man Bad all over again. This is what the establishment press does. They attack the president. They don't want him to win. But when it comes to the primaries, you better believe they're not going to allow the populist left a chance either. So here's what I'm really hoping for. And I'm not sure it's going to happen, but I'm really hoping for this. I'm hoping that as we see bipartisan support from the populist sections for shows like Rising with Crystal and Cigar. It's a truly great show. They're honest. They're completely honest. It's amazing. Crystal Ball is a former MSNBC host, and they actually had me on, and it was a fair and rational discussion. They weren't condescending or insulting. It was like, let's talk about it. And to see the socialists actually praise a conservative, I'm like, this is the unity we really need. We need to get rid of the lying, like, fake news press. We need to get rid of, you know, look at this. Rachel Maddow, she's there for the bunking, absent for the debunkings. We need to get rid of that, 100%. And we need to challenge Donald Trump, and we need to challenge Bernie Sanders on their political issues, okay? What they stand for and why they think it will work, tear it down. I mean, like, literally, come up with an argument and tear it down and have a real discussion. Because guess, I'll tell you this, you might be the staunchest Bernie Sanders supporter, but if you sit down and have a conversation and a Trump supporter explains why the idea works and it makes sense, you might have no choice but to be like, maybe that is a good idea, because no one's lying about it. That's the problem. They try and push this narrative about Trump working for Russia because they have no real arguments as to why his policies make no sense. They say the border wall is immoral. And again, a lot of the criticism will fall on the left for this too. It doesn't matter if you're progressive or establishment. I think the left has made the mistake of too often ignoring legitimate arguments and coming up with these more emotional reactions. But I'll tell you this, while I'm not entirely convinced many of these progressives will actually heed this warning and start ignoring the press, some of them are starting to get it, right? We just saw Soledad O'Brien slam CNN for having liars on the air. Okay, I'm hoping we'll see some unity. And at the very least, if you really do think the other side is evil and wrong, a Trump supporter, a Bernie supporter, or a Tulsi supporter, or a Warren supporter, whatever, we need to get rid of all that. We need to get rid of all of that and take a look at what the socialists have to say. Because if they're willing to make the first step and say that a conservative co-host bring us an amazing show, I'll be the first to say absolutely, 100%, thank you. Because what we need, you know, we have a show that's not Crossfire. Remember Crossfire where they're like Democrat and conservative and they like argue with each other? No, we quite literally have two hosts who respect each other with different opinions having a real show and a real conversation. And you know what? The establishment press has attacked and assailed The Hill and John Solomon, formerly of The Hill, for being, you know, fake news and Russian propaganda. Nah, sorry. This is a light at the end of the tunnel. A light at the end of the tunnel. I'm hoping that, you know, I'll definitely make sure I give a shout out on the other side, because I think Hannity as well has his faults. Now, here's the thing. Let me show you this. Glenn Greenwald said, in response to that tweet about Rachel Maddow being nuts, by stark contrast, Matt Taibbi's new book, Hate Inc., is genuinely one of the best accounts written in years of how the U.S. political media deceives, divides, and propagandizes. It covers Russiagate, explains Trump, eviscerates Maddow and CNN, and much more. And that's the thing you need to read. I'll tell you this. I'll tell you my thoughts. I'm not trying to be someone who's going to be a tribalist pointing at Maddow and being like, she's so evil and wrong. Aha, we're winning. No, I think Hannity is bad as well. Here's the difference. Hannity is bombastic. Okay. Hannity is tribal. Hannity wasn't pushing insane nonsense. Okay. When he talks about the Ukrainian meddling, and he's been criticized by CNN for this, he's actually citing real articles. He's just being hyperbolic, but those stories are based in fact. Rachel Maddow is there for the bunking, not for the debunking. And now that the Mueller report has shown her to be wrong, yeah, she needs to come out and be like, okay, I was wrong about that. I'm no fan of Hannity, but I do think there is a slight difference. Just because we can point out, you know, Matt Taibbi can point out two different sides of this partisan bubble of shouting and attacking the other side, doesn't mean that they're equivalents. I think Rachel Maddow was peddling insane conspiracy nonsense. I think, you know, Sean Hannity is bombastic and exaggerates. There's a big difference. But I'll leave you with one final thought on this. The main point I want to drive home is that The Washington Post launches this, right? The six-part series saying, here's who was wrong. And now we're actually seeing people on the left point out the media lies and everything like that. And if the socialists are willing to contend that you have a show with a conservative that's actually good, I think we're heading down the right path. But when it comes to the media, when it comes to what people consume, it's not just the press. I want you to consider this. According to Newswhip, a media analytics company, in 2018, conservatives got most of their news or gauged mostly on Facebook with Fox News. Fox News is biased, sometimes wrong. They do have a corrections policy and they do exaggerate. They do have a perspective. I think there's a problem if you only get your news from Fox. However, Democrats primarily engaged with and got information from Occupy Democrats, a conspiracy meme generating Facebook page. That is scary to me. So if we can at least agree that The Hill's Rising show is a good show with good hosts that are honest, that have a good debate, I think we're gonna be better off because we can get the left and the right to finally sit down and watch a show both can agree is being fair. That's a very, very important step in the right direction. I'll tell you this, man, the Rising with The Hill is 10 times better than anything I do when it comes to like talking about politics and stuff like that. I'm sure there's an argument to be made for like me doing a bit more in-depth and research and stuff like that, fine. But I think when it comes to actually having a political conversation, The Hill is better because it isn't just one person with, you know, a certain opinion, be it liberal, conservative, or otherwise. It's literally a progressive and a conservative having a conversation with various hosts and being honest about it. So I know it's a really, really big shout out for you guys over at The Hill. You guys are awesome, by the way. So I'm glad to see that. You know, we can see socialists praising a conservative. That's awesome. And hopefully now with people calling out Rachel Maddow and it becoming more acceptable to do so among left and right, perhaps we can get rid of the crony lying media machine and have a real conversation. Bernie Sanders has done a lot of pandering I don't like, but and it is what it is, okay? But I want to have a real conversation about the issues, a real conversation. I'd love to see Donald Trump go on the Joe Rogan podcast, same as Bernie Sanders did. And I want to see someone hold their feet to the fire, both Trump and Bernie. I want to hear a real argument about why their ideas do or don't make sense. And I would like everyone to kind of calm down because I look at the comment section on even my videos and it's like, chill, right? Let's do our best to have a good faith conversation and win with the battle of ideas, right? I can argue against you and say why you're wrong. And if we can leave with a handshake and I'll see you at the voting booth, we're better off. The first thing we got to do is get rid of the fearmonger conspiracy peddlers. Alex Jones gets banned. They go after him and say he's pushing nonsense. What about Rachel Maddow? Where's her reckoning? Perhaps it's coming. I certainly hope it is. My favorite line from all of this, and this is the last thing I'll show you. She's there for the bunkings, absent for the debunkings. And that explains exactly what the problem is. So I'll leave it there. You get the point. Thanks for hanging out. I'll see you all in the next segment at 6 p.m. youtube.com/timcastnews. Again, thanks for hanging out.